Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 13221 in the name of Tom Arthur on aggregate tax and devolved taxes administration Scotland Bill at stage one. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Tom Arthur to speak to and move the motion at around 9 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This bill provides for the key elements of a new devolved tax on the commercial exploitation of aggregate in Scotland. This will replace the UK aggregates levy when introduced. It reflects an all-party recommendation of the Smith Commission and draws on the powers provided in the Scotland Act 2016. The bill proposals will also support the effective and efficient collection of all devolved taxes by Revenue Scotland. I want to thank the Finance and Public Administration Committee for their detailed scrutiny of the bill and their Stage 1 report, and I am pleased that the committee supports the general principles of the bill. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank everyone who gave evidence during the Stage 1 process and the many stakeholders who have supported the development of the legislation thus far. This bill has been drafted with the help of significant expert feedback and has been informed by a programme of quarry visits, meetings with aggregate producers and businesses focused on the production of recycled materials. I am keen to maintain this positive engagement as we move forward and prepare for the future operation of a Scottish aggregates tax. In particular, we will continue the expert advisory group that was convened specifically to provide advice on this bill. Before addressing the committee's report, I want to recognise the important contribution aggregates make to the Scottish economy and to reflect briefly on the different types of aggregate. I'll give way to Mr Ewing.
Fergus Ewing.
I welcome his assurance about continued engagement. I believe the industry have asked for a mineral products forum to be established, perhaps in statute and statutorily agreed, and I think that would be an excellent idea to make sure that going forward there's stability, continuity and best collaborative working. Is that something that the Minister will consider sympathetically?
Minister.
I'm happy to give that assurance that ministers will consider all constructive suggestions, such as the one just offered by Mr Ewing, very seriously. And I would want to put on record my thanks to Mr Ewing for his constructive engagement on this legislation at an early stage. Presiding Officer, aggregates provide materials for housing, energy, infrastructure, construction and road building, and the aggregates industry supports employment across Scotland, including in rural and remote areas. Most aggregates currently used in Scotland are primary aggregates, crushed rock, gravel and sand, which are produced from naturally occurring mineral deposits and used for the first time. These vital aggregates are produced in quarries the length and breadth of Scotland. Secondary aggregates are by-products of industrial and construction processes, and recycled aggregates are materials previously used in construction. Thanks to the industry's ongoing innovation, the range and quality of recycled materials is continuously improving. To encourage the minimum necessary exploitation of primary aggregates, maximise the use of secondary and recycled aggregates, and incentivise innovation and the development of alternative materials, this bill provides for a tax on the commercial exploitation of primary aggregates in Scotland. This, combined with other measures such as the Scottish landfill tax, will support our wider ambitions to deliver a fair, green and growing economy, and more specifically our ambitions for the circular economy. Certainly.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Minister for giving way, and I think he makes an important point about the need to improve the proportion of secondary recycled aggregates. But would he also agree with me that we also need to look at the non-fiscal measures to encourage those uses, such as use of making sure that standards for construction, road building and so on actually keep pace with technology to ensure that we do that, not just using fiscal measures to do that?
Minister.
Absolutely. I think Mr Johnson makes a very important point, and as I highlighted at the committee, this is just one of a suite of tools that will be available to ministers and to Parliament to help promote a circular economy. But I agree with him, it has to be situated within that broader suite of regulatory and non-regulatory interventions to support these ambitions. Presiding Officer, turning now to the specifics of the Stage 1 report, concerns were raised about the lack of data on the impact of the UK aggregates levy and the challenges presents for assessing behavioural impact. In particular, there is no disaggregated HMRC data available for the UK aggregates levy at a Scotland or sub-Scotland level. With this in mind, the approach taken to this bill, particularly the decision to align with the UK aggregates levy, is pragmatic and sensible. It considers the views I have heard throughout our consultation and engagement process and the data limitations the committee highlights. The Scottish Government is also working closely with Revenue Scotland and the expert advisory group to consider opportunities to improve the evidence base. The committee also questioned whether there was a potential tension between the desire for continuity and the effective incentivisation of recycled and secondary aggregates use. The approach set out in this bill ensures that there is a price signal to encourage the use of recycled, secondary and alternative aggregates, whilst ensuring stability and certainty for taxpayers. It also allows for the tax to evolve over time, informed by Scotland-specific data collection and increased understanding of the tax and its impact on the aggregates industry in Scotland. I'm also conscious that there was a strong interest in the future tax rate. The proposed introduction date of this tax is, however, 2 years away, and decisions on any tax rate will be set out as part of the Scottish budget process. I recognise the desire for clarity on this matter, and am mindful of the importance of stability and certainty for taxpayers as we introduce a new tax. We will therefore work closely with stakeholders to inform decisions on future tax policy. Separately, the committee noted the importance of cross-border movements of aggregate, in particular the interaction between the UK aggregates levy and the new Scottish tax. Extensive consideration, informed by stakeholder engagement, has been given to the appropriate approach for accounting for cross-border movements. The approach set out in the bill is the most administratively straightforward for taxpayers and wider businesses. The committee also reported concerns from taxpayers about the current levels of compliance with the UK aggregates levy regime. On this, our focus is on ensuring that the arrangements for the Scottish aggregates tax work as intended, and that there is a level playing field for all. The bill thus includes a distinctive provision that allows for the charging of tax on those that purchase taxable aggregate from unregistered suppliers. The tax will also provide an opportunity to demonstrate the operational benefits of tax devolution, making the best use of Revenue Scotland operational expertise. The second part of the bill includes a small number of provisions that will further optimise the administration of all devolved taxes. I know that stakeholders have raised concerns about the lack of consultation on these provisions. However, the provisions have been informed by detailed engagement with Revenue Scotland and are either minor points of clarification, create consistency with powers already applying in Scotland to UK taxes, or are enabling powers where a full public consultation will be conducted in advance of any secondary legislation. Part 2 includes two enabling powers which will allow Scottish ministers to make regulations on how Revenue Scotland communicates with taxpayers and how they make use of automation. The aim of the powers is to future-proof our tax legislation and ensure that Scotland can continue to make use of modern advancements in its tax systems. I am ever conscious of the need to safeguard taxpayers, and my response to the Stage 1 report sets out a number of ways in which taxpayers' interests will be protected, and I am sure that this will be discussed in more detail during the debate. Part 2 also includes provisions which will allow Revenue Scotland to set off undisputed amounts of taxpayer debits against the same taxpayers' credits. This provision will aid Revenue Scotland's ability to efficiently collect taxes while not disadvantaging the taxpayer. Again, I am happy to discuss the safeguards which will be available to taxpayers on this matter. Overall, these provisions will allow us to create and maintain a modern, efficient and effective tax system fit for modern Scotland. The bill is just one element of the Scottish Government's ambitious programme to drive forward towards a circular economy and net zero, but it is a key element. The bill delivers on a cross-party agreement to devolve further tax-raising powers to the Scottish Parliament. The proposals are the result of extensive stakeholder engagement, and ministers are committed to continuing this engagement as the bill progresses through Parliament. I look forward to our discussion and debate this afternoon, and I would ask members to support the bill at decision time. And I move the motion, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. I now call on Liz Smith to speak on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Around 7 minutes, Ms Smith.
Thank you. And first of all, may I extend the apologies of our convener, Kenny Gibson, who is unable to be present this afternoon. He has given me quite a lot of ideas to reflect upon our committee deliberations. Now, as part of our scrutiny, the committee ran a call for written reviews, which received 10 responses. We took oral evidence from stakeholders at 3 meetings throughout March, and we visited an aggregates recycling facility in Livingston. We're very grateful to everybody who took the time to share their insights and help inform our consideration of the bill. So I want to highlight some of the key issues raised in the committee's report on the bill, which we published on the 29th of April, and respond to a few of the comments in the Scottish Government's response. Part one of the bill introduces the Scottish Aggregates Tax, which is a tax on the commercial exploitation of primary aggregates to be administered by Revenue Scotland. That proposed SAT retains the fundamental structure of the UK aggregates levy, with the stated aim of offering, and I quote, a degree of continuity for taxpayers, while also ensuring that the devolved tax can evolve over time to support the Scottish Government's circular economy objectives. The bill provides the legislative framework for the operation of the tax, but does not set the specific tax rate, which would obviously be established as part of a Scottish Government budget process. The evidence received by the committee broadly supports the general principle that a tax be levied on the commercial exploitation of primary aggregates. Most respondents agreed that the proposed SAT aligns with the Scottish Government's Framework for Tax 2021 and with the principles and strategic objectives that underpin the Scottish Government's approach to taxation. And they also generally welcome the consistency with the UK treatment of the tax. On exactly the same basis as the UK levy, the SAT is an environmental tax which aims to reduce the extraction of primary aggregate. So part of our scrutiny focused on the tension between maximising recycling rates to contribute to the environmental aims of the bill, but also keeping the tax as simple as possible. Witnesses broadly agreed that it would be preferable to match the rate charged by the UK levy to prevent behavioural change and competition. And it's good to see that the Minister acknowledges that stability and continuity are vitally important. We also heard that the use of secondary aggregates could be expanded and that the quality of recycled materials is continuously improving. Stakeholders told us that the availability of materials fluctuates according to the changes in construction and demolition markets. That said, it is the market and financial incentives available that dictate the amount of aggregate that is recycled. Stakeholders told us that there is still a general perception that secondary aggregates are somewhat inferior and that the lack of demand for these, coupled with the current low rates for the aggregates and landfill tax, contributes to potentially recyclable material still ending up in landfill. So the committee has expressed reservations regarding the potential of the SAT to incentivise the switch to recycled secondary products and reduce the use of natural products, a key ambition of the bill, without there also being an increase in the tax rate above that that is currently charged, or broadening the use and classification of recycled aggregates, which I think is a key point from the committee's deliberations. One of the main challenges we identified during scrutiny of the bill was the lack of relevant data, which I hope the Scottish Government will understand is a very serious concern, since it impacts on the scrutiny process. For example, we heard that HMRC does not currently hold Scotland-specific data on the volume of taxable material located in Scotland or moved throughout the UK. And while we understand the current limitations with regards to the availability of disaggregated data, our committee is strongly of the view that such data is essential in order to establish tax elasticities and enable future governments to set an appropriate rate of tax that will achieve the circular economy ambitions. Yes, of course.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank her very much for giving way, and referencing data is a point I'm going to make when I speak about it as well. But I think we need to be clear. Data that the Scottish Government doesn't hold is actually data that the UK Government doesn't collect. And I think we need to emphasise the need for disaggregated Scottish data across the piece. Would you agree?
Ms Smith.
Yes, absolutely, I would agree. And I know that Michelle Thompson has been very active on citing several instances where we feel that the data is not appropriate for some of the legislation. And it's not just a case of UK government not being able to disaggregate the information that we need. It's also a case that the Scottish Government needs to have access to that data to be able for us to do our job properly, whether that's in committee or in the chamber. Now, we also heard concerns regarding non-compliance with the existing tax regime, and that was really on an anecdotal evidence base rather than anything that was scientific. So we don't really have terribly much information about that, but it was put to us by a lot of stakeholders that there is anecdotal evidence about this non-compliance, and I think that's an area of concern to the committee, and our report welcomes Revenue Scotland's intended approach to ensure that compliance and enforcement are very much better in the future. So our report calls on Revenue Scotland to work very closely with the local authorities to identify quarrying activity and how that works. Now, with regard to part two of the bill, the Minister has mentioned that there have been very considerable concerns about the lack of consultation within that. These proposals in that part of the bill, I appreciate that the Minister says that they follow detailed discussions with Revenue Scotland, but I think those in the industry want to see much greater consultation when it comes to this, because it is important that, the lack of consultation has given a bit of cause for concern that the bill will not be complete unless that consultation is taken on board. And I think the committee shares those concerns, and we therefore noted in our report that such an approach does not support effective policy making unless we can have that full round of evidence. Now, I will finish on the basis, I've still got a lot to say, but I will finish on the basis, Deputy Presiding Officer, given that I've only got 7 minutes. I think from a committee aspect, the general feeling is that we would like to support the principles of this bill, but as yet we don't feel that we have enough information for the scrutiny process to be as accurate as it could be. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Smith. And I call Jamie Hawker-Johnson, around 6 minutes. Mr Hawker-Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be opening this debate for the Scottish Conservatives, but I also have the great honour of closing it too. So, two speeches from me, both on the aggregates tax, all on one afternoon. Colleagues across the chamber must feel all their Christmases have come early. But this is a notable piece of legislation because the aggregates levy was devolved alongside other taxes as part of the Scotland Act 2016, and here we are just 8 years later, finally getting round to it. As a member of the Finance Committee, can I thank all of our witnesses for their contributions to our Stage 1 scrutiny, and of course Spice and our clerks for their support and efforts in helping us put together our Stage 1 report. As my colleague Liz Smith said, speaking on behalf, of course, of the committee, as she's already highlighted, this bill will update the levy on aggregates collected in Scotland and the administration of devolved taxes as part of the Scottish Government's circular economy goals. The Scottish Conservatives are supportive of the principles of the bill, but we recognise many of the concerns raised in the Finance Committee's report, and we hope that the Scottish Government will address the outstanding concerns highlighted during the evidence sessions taken on the bill. I would like to focus my opening speech on just some of those concerns. Firstly, while it is welcome that there appears to be collaborative relationship between Revenue Scotland and HMRC, and that there will be formal data sharing arrangements with HMRC, data on the aggregates tax is not expected to be transferred at the start of the process, leaving HMRC working from scratch. And concerningly, one of the issues that the Finance Committee has heard time and time again, and Liz Smith also raised, both in relation to this bill and in other areas, is a lack of relevant data. There simply isn't the disaggregated data at a Scotland or sub-Scotland level available from HMRC relating to the UK levy or more widely, and the Finance Committee was strongly of the view that this data is needed to establish the tax elasticity and to allow for future Scottish governments to set SAT rate at the right level to achieve both its aims and manage the risk of behavioural change. I recognise, as was pointed out by Michelle Thompson, that this is an issue with how HMRC collects its data, and I do welcome, in the Scottish Government's response to our report, assurances that they are working with Revenue Scotland on how to improve data collection when Revenue Scotland takes over administering the tax. The committee was also concerned about the issue of compliance or current non-compliance and how that would be addressed going forward. There was anecdotal evidence from industry that this was at significant levels, including in the islands, and this was impacting on some businesses and their economic competitiveness with others. I have to admit that certainly on the smaller scale non-compliance, I'm surprised that the reward outweighs the risks. The tax at the current rate, and I know it's increasing, but the current rate of £2 and £3 per tonne would only be around £40 for 20 tonnes of aggregate, and I suspect much of the non-compliance is due to lack of awareness or because it is either traditional or occasional extraction. Perhaps that is an area where Revenue Scotland can target non-compliance with better awareness of responsibilities. However, I do accept that for larger amounts that would be a different picture, and the committee welcomes Revenue Scotland's assurances that would be a focus on compliance and on enforcement. I remain slightly sceptical that because this is only the third tax that Revenue Scotland is administering, that this will somehow allow it, certainly in the early days, to more effectively target non-compliance and ensure all taxes collected. But engagement with industry and other stakeholders will be key, and it is welcome that this certainly appears to be the part of the approach that Revenue Scotland is advocating. Of course, given we don't have the full data on how much of UCAL is currently paid in Scotland, it will be harder to make comparisons on how efficient Revenue Scotland is when compared to HMRC. And the last area I want to look at is effectiveness. Will this actually work and meet its objectives? Well, there are reservations there too. As Liz Smith highlighted, the committee heard that while the quality of recycled material was improving, they were still considered inferior to primary aggregates. And there are issues over availability and consistency of supply. So that would suggest decisions on the use of recycled materials, the objective of the tax, will come down to price point, and that the rate will likely dictate the success of whether the SAT achieves its environmental objectives and encourages use of more recycled material and less primary aggregates. But witnesses largely agreed that the rate should be kept in line with the UK rate, and the Minister, in his response and also today, accepted that stability and continuity will be important considerations on how any changes to the rate are made. And considering the importance of the construction sector, and with Scotland finally declaring a housing emergency only yesterday and a recognition of the need to increase house building, the Scottish Government will likely have to choose between environmental and economic targets. Because putting up the rate to a level that could see real behavioural change and the significantly increased use of recycled materials also risks increasing construction costs and tightening already tight margins. And Presiding Officer, I will draw my initial contributions to a close there and come on some of the other issues I have in my closing speech, and I look forward to hearing from other colleagues on their thoughts on the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Harker-Johnson. I now call on Michael Manna. Around 5 minutes, Mr. Manna.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Labour welcomes the establishment of the Scottish Aggregates Tax, and we will support the general principles of the bill. Can I thank the Minister for his engagement early on in this process with myself and with colleagues. Obviously, the power, as members have already mentioned, was originally devolved in the wide-ranging application of further powers to this Parliament that came about after the Smith Commission and the Scotland Act in 2016. It's perhaps not the leading light of some of those powers in terms of we often talk of the child benefit that's been brought into being as a result of that. But no matter, we have to get on and we have to ensure that this tax is introduced by the 1st of April 2026. And the policy memorandum for the bill states that the Scottish Aggregates Tax will retain the fundamental structure of the UK Aggregates Levy as this offers a degree of continuity for taxpayers. And it is welcome the Scottish Government have heeded the request of industry to mirror UK Aggregates Levy to a very large extent, given that many businesses will be operating in both jurisdictions. Difference for difference sake would serve absolutely no one. However, there are some conflicting signals coming from the Scottish Government as to the future intentions for the tax. And the policy memorandum for the bill states that the Scottish Government intends that SAT will align with wider ambitions to deliver a fair, green and growing economy, in particular the Scottish Government's ambitions for a circular economy. And those are laudable ambitions, and Scottish Labour certainly wants to see a fair, green and growing economy. The policy memorandum goes on to say that the tax will achieve this by encouraging the minimum necessary exploitation of primary aggregates and maximising the use of secondary and recycled aggregates. As the Mineral Products Association Scotland highlighted in evidence to the Finance Committee, the tax does nothing to increase the availability of recycled or secondary aggregate. There are also limits to the extent to which recycled materials can be used instead of primary aggregate, with SEPA noting that recycled aggregates are very unlikely to displace virgin aggregate use altogether. Therefore, it is hard to see how this will be achieved without increasing the rate of SAT. Continually increasing the rate of SAT to incentivise the use of recycled material would lead to greater divergence from the UK levy, something which industry and government have both said that they wish to avoid. So my concerns are not so much that the vast quantities of aggregate material will be transported south of the border. Evidence taken by the committee was clear that, given the costs of transportation, there is not a significant flow of aggregates across the border in that regard. I'm sure Parliament and industry would appreciate clarification from the Minister as to how the balance will be struck between the circular economy aims and the stability and continuity of which he spoke in his committee appearance. So now turning to part two of the bill, it does appear that some of the provisions could be akin to using a hammer to crack a nut. Section 52 seeks to prevent a taxpayer making a repayment claim where they have failed to pay an amount of a different tax. And Section 56 would allow Revenue Scotland to offset a taxpayer's credit against the debit. At present, there are two devolved taxes, land and buildings transaction tax and Scottish landfill tax. Should this bill pass, there will be three. And the Chartered Institute of Taxation questioned the proportionality and necessity of these measures, while the Law Society suggested it was disproportionate in a tax system which includes two devolved taxes. The Institute of Chartered Accountants also voiced similar concerns. So Section 56 is based on equivalent provisions of the UK Finance Act 2008, Section 130. But these provisions have only been used on very rare occasions in the UK, a much larger jurisdiction than Scotland. The Law Society pointed out that these provisions of the UK Act are seen by some as an extreme measure. So, responding to concerns regarding taxpayer protection, if I have the time, I'm happy to do so.
Michelle Thompson.
Thank you very much. I do appreciate the giveaway. I would perhaps make the point that arguably the UK government should be using these sort of measures much more frequently. I'm on record commenting in this parliament that an estimated £262 billion is lost to UK GDP each and every year as a result of tax avoidance, money laundering and so on. And I think that rather puts that into context.
Michael Mara.
I very much agree with Michelle Thompson. I think that financial crime in that regard, tax avoidance, is a far greater crime and a problem for this country than it is often given cognizance of. I would say that the regulations in this legislation, and I quote, set off would come into effect where there was no dispute about the amount of tax that was due. So not necessarily a particularly sharp instrument to deal with the issues that Michelle Thompson raises. However, it's not explicitly set out in the bill as introduced, and I would welcome clarity from the Minister as to whether it has been made explicit around this idea about there has to be agreement between parties in regard to the offset. I will come to a conclusion, Presiding Officer. In closing, I welcome the introduction of the Scottish Aggregates Tax and the sensible approach the Scottish Government appears to be taking, recognising that Scotland's taxes do not exist in a vacuum, but rather that they interact with the wider UK tax system. It is essential if we are to build a system in Scotland that works for the benefit of taxpayers and businesses and raises revenue in a sustainable way. And I do urge the Government to take the sensible approach, the same approach with all its fiscal decisions.
Thank you. I now call on Ross Greer, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Greens welcome and support this bill. I've got to say, I do feel like a somewhat of an interloper in this debate, because as much as I'm a member of the Finance Committee that scrutinised the bill at Stage 1, I was absent for all of the Stage 1 proceedings because I was substituting on the Health Committee. I even missed the committee's visit to a quarry. I'm still waiting on Michael Mara bringing me back the pet rock that I was promised. But I am glad that the bill is finally before Parliament. This is not a headline-grabbing element of what was agreed 10 years ago, but it is important. I think it's timely that it's going through concurrently with the Circular Economy Bill. The policy memorandum makes clear, and indeed the Minister made clear in opening this afternoon, that this bill does form an important part of the Government's ambition for Scotland to develop a much more circular economy and to reduce our waste, something that I believe is an ambition shared across the Chamber. We do want to maximise the use of recycled aggregate and minimise the extraction of fresh aggregate. But there is a challenge here. It's highlighted in the committee report that it's not yet clear the extent to which this bill or the aggregate tax, once it comes in, will contribute towards that objective, because the Scottish Government has also emphasised, for quite understandable reasons, the desire to have continuity with the existing UK-wide scheme. I think Daniel Johnson made an important point in his opening for Labour on the need for us to also consider, as part of this wider package, non-fiscal measures like construction standards to further incentivise that circular economy in the construction industry. I agree on the need for this tax to be as simple as possible, particularly given that it's not likely to ever have a particularly high revenue yield, and the more complicated we make it, the more the administrative costs take up a chunk of what is actually being raised. But I would urge the Minister to give more detail on the Government's overall direction of travel here ahead of Stage 3 as to how this bill is going to maximise its contribution towards that more circular economy. To add something new to the debate, though, I do think that there's one part of the overall picture here that's missing. Far too often, buildings that are capable of being refurbished in Scotland are demolished because it's simply more cost-effective. Demolition is cheap. In fact, demolition itself and most elements of the construction of new buildings are exempt from VAT. And the construction of new buildings is typically far more carbon and resource intensive than refurbishment, even when that construction is using recycled material. The Scottish Greens have long supported calls to reduce VAT on refurbishment and restoration, but that's a reserved issue and not for this Parliament. I think we do need to look at the financial levers that are within our power to further incentivise these less carbon and resource intensive and environmentally degrading forms of work. And it is within our power to create a demolition levy. That's something that's been long advocated for by the Chartered Institute of Building and a number of figures and organisations within the construction industry. An aggregates tax and demolition levy together would be a much more effective way of incentivising that less carbon and resource intensive forms of building practices. A demolition levy under the current terms of the Scotland Act would need to be a local power, but I think that's no bad thing, giving local government yet more fiscal empowerment. And it would also contribute towards the preservation of our built heritage. It's not hard to see how much good a demolition levy would do in areas like Glasgow, where we've lost so much of our built heritage in recent years, primarily for the reasons that I've just mentioned. This is overall a very competent bill. I agree with the Finance and DPLR Committee's recommendations about the changes that are required to it, but the changes that are primarily required here are outwith the scope of the legislation itself. They're more about the operational challenges, particularly in relation to data. So I would like to congratulate the Minister and the Bill team for a very competent and well-put-together bill. It's something that Scottish Greens will be more than happy to support, but there are significant challenges going forward, and I think for the purposes of post-legislative scrutiny, I would encourage the Minister to bring as much information to Parliament ahead of Stage 3 as possible to inform the debate going forward. Thank you.
Thank you. And now call on Willie Rennie. Up to 4 minutes, please.
I've got a direct interest in well-managed quarries. I've got several of them in my constituency, and they are incredibly important for the construction of houses, of railways, of schools, but also key public infrastructure. So this is an incredibly important debate, although it may sound incredibly dull. But nevertheless, it is important. It's only me that's dull, says Daniel Johnson. But the industry was concerned in the early stages that the government spoke of creating a new and distinctive tax. They were also concerned about the pace of the progress on the legislation. They had particular concerns regarding cross-border issues that we've already discussed this afternoon. And they did highlight to me the nature of the complexities and the scale of the issues involved for what is rightly a small revenue, but nevertheless very important for this sector that we get it right. So I urge the Minister to include representatives of the sector in a working group similar to that which was helpful in the development of the UK levy. And I'm using this opportunity, thankfully on a sleepy Thursday afternoon that hopefully nobody is watching, to praise the Minister effusively for responding to that very positively and engaging the industry. And I had very positive responses from the sector about his particular engagement with them and making sure that their voices were heard. So full marks to the Minister in that regard. And the technical advisory group met several times, including the industry. And I understand that there was a visit to Angle Park near Ladybank in my constituency, which was very helpful in explaining those complexities. Now, I think it's good to have a bit of stability in transition. I think this is an important piece of legislation, an important new tax power. But when we don't really know all the aspects of the revenue, where it's coming from, how it's spent, we need to just move slowly. And so we understand more. So I understand the criticisms about the lack of information, but I think that emphasises the point about just having a smooth transition so we don't disrupt the industry, so we don't cause anxiety, so that we are able to get a cost-effective delivery of the items, the aggregates, for the construction sector at a time when inflation is going through the roof. So we need to make sure that we keep this under control. And I noticed that the Minister wasn't giving anything away about the rate that would be set, but I did read the mood music from the Minister and the caution that he indicated, which I very much welcome. I think that was the right thing to do. Now, when I was the MP for Dunfermline and West Fife, I had Long Annet Power Station in my constituency, and there was a company called Scottish that were taking the fly ash from the chimneys, from the flues, and turning it into cement. And it was a much more low-cost, low-energy intensive cement-making material. Now, that was incredibly difficult to get the industry to engage with it, to use it, mainly because it was different. The standard, actually, the quality was very, very good, but because it was different, and they were used to using the materials they had always used. So why would they change? So tax is important to encourage that new behaviour, and it, because this industry is used to doing what it's used to doing. So therefore, I think I can understand why we need to make sure we are incentivising secondary and recycled materials in a sensible way, because the industry does need encouragement, and I'm sure they would recognise that themselves. I think the other aspects that the Law Society of Scotland, I think, are worth airing this afternoon in terms of part two, the LBTT group relief, I hope there is some consideration of amendments in that regard, but also the subsale development relief, that's the limit of my knowledge on those two fronts, are considered for amendments, but also perhaps an annual round of care and maintenance as part of the finance bill that comes forward every year perhaps could be considered as well. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to open debate speeches. I'd be grateful if all members who wish to speak were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call John Mason to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to take part today. Now, a new tax may not be seen as all that exciting by many people, but for those of us in the Finance Committee, it's our bread and butter, and we'll all be queuing up to speak in the debate this afternoon. This is the third fully devolved Scottish tax after LBTT and landfill tax, and in one sense it's not new, but just replacing a UK aggregates levy. However, it's still important and has potential, not least if we're serious about encouraging recycling and depending less on using primary aggregates like crushed rock, gravel and sand. The committee did hear somewhat conflicting evidence on the use of recycled materials and how much that could be expanded. MPA Scotland told us that the tax cannot directly minimise the exploitation of virgin aggregates. However, representatives of the aggregate recycling industry told us that the use of secondary aggregates could be expanded. They feel that the current tax regime, including UKAL and landfill tax, discourages recycling. We saw the kind of equipment required when we visited Brewster's, and that clearly adds cost to their product as opposed to virgin material. This bill does not set the rate of tax that will happen in the budget, but the current assumption is it will match the UK rate of £2.03 per tonne at the moment. However, I personally remain unconvinced that we need to slavishly track the UK on this matter. With landfill tax, we have always feared waste tourism if the UK and Scottish tax rates diverged. However, it does seem that aggregate is used much more locally and would not be moved huge distances even if the rates varied. Local authorities were suggesting they should not pay the tax at all. However, that would remove the incentive to recycle. But I did think there might be an argument for a lower rate on the islands and other locations further from the central belt, as they have higher costs anyway and do not have the option of using recycled materials. In some ways, it does seem odd that SAT should be based on the place of commercial exploitation rather than at the point of production. However, that is what the Scotland Act 2016 requires, and theoretically we could export much more aggregate than we import, and we would gain no extra tax on that whatsoever. This seems like a miniature replica of our whisky exports, which adds so little to the public purse because there is no production tax. This does not seem entirely satisfactory to me. However, we have to play the hand that we have been dealt. One of the costs of this legislation, though hopefully not significant, is that as well as Scotland paying for Revenue Scotland and the new tax, Scotland also has to pay for HMRC and the UK switching off their tax. So despite the fact the devolution of aggregates taxation has been jointly agreed by the UK and Scotland, we in Scotland have to pay the costs of both sides. Hopefully these will be relatively small amounts of money, but it strikes me as being incredibly unfair and basically exploitation by Westminster. Part two of the bill has next to nothing to do with the aggregates tax, but rather updates the administration of Scottish taxes more generally. Witnesses highlighted the lack of public consultation, and I think the committee shared these concerns. The need for this part of the bill has again highlighted the lack of opportunities for tidying up existing financial legislation, and I personally am supportive of the idea of an annual, or perhaps biannual, finance bill for this purpose. I'm glad to see that the government is not entirely opposed to that. There was also some concern about increased automation, with many people still digitally excluded and who really struggle if they cannot speak or interact with real people. Revenue Scotland gave us some reassurance on this point, but I think it is something we all need to keep an eye on. The Law Society of Scotland has suggested further desirable amendments, including LBTT group relief and Scottish share pledges. This is to do with changes from 2018, which could not be made retrospective at the time, but which I understand the government agreed should be made retrospective. So I guess the question now is whether the government would accept amendments at stage two to deal with this anomaly. So overall, I'm happy to support the bill. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer. And aggregates, of course, is a relatively specialist sector, but the details of legislation affecting it matters. Different aggregates are extracted, sorted and processed in different ways, and it's important that is reflected in how they are taxed. And one of the issues that was brought to me for consideration was, for example, a farmer extracting aggregates from his own land and using it on his own land and would be taxed similarly. So I think there are things to be considered here. Scottish Conservatives are supportive of the general principles of the bill, but it's clear there are opportunities for improvements to avoid creating bigger issues in the future. We've already heard today the discussion around data collection and use of technology. And more often, we're finding that gaps in our knowledge are a barrier to effective legislation and administration. And we see that here again, and while I welcome the commitment to address those gaps, there remains a lack of detail on how and when that will be achieved. Gathering that data, whether at a desk or in the field, will increasingly rely on the application of technology, be it AI, analysis of taxpayer-submitted reports, or the use of drones, GPS and other technologies to locate and monitor the activities of those working in the sector. While there is a recognition of that reality in the bill, it's not immediately obvious how that recognition will be taken forward and applied effectively in a way which retains public confidence. And in discussing stakeholder engagement and multi-agency working, it does appear that the approach to consultation with stakeholders thus far has been patchier than perhaps it should have been. Given the importance of ensuring that the implementation of this levy is not overburdensome on taxpayers and aligns with wider objectives, it would make sense that the widest possible consultation and engagement from the earliest possible stage. And similarly, given the desire to use this bill to facilitate greater enforcement, there is a clear need to see a commitment to ensure agencies across government and the industry are working collaboratively. I do appreciate the Scottish Government's argument that the kind of recurring finance bill required to carry out general updates to legislation around the administration of tax could place an additional burden on Parliament's limited time and resource. However, when set against the concerns raised by consultees and stakeholders in respect of the changes appended to this bill, I believe an approach which offers a clearer and simpler approach to legislation of this type is well worth considering. Similarly, I'm firmly of the view that the easier it is for taxpayers to understand the system and avoid overburdening them with excessive administration, the more effective our tax system will be in the longer term. Finally, I think the intent over the longer term to use this tax as a means of reducing the use of extraction of virgin aggregates in favour of encouraging growth in the use of recycled aggregates is laudable and for many reasons highly desirable. However, I am concerned that the Scottish Government have had a preference for driving change through increased costs and other prohibitive measures, often without sufficient recognition of the need to balance this with support to facilitate change and encourage innovation. I would leave this debate, or finish my contribution to this debate, by encouraging the Scottish Government to offer more detail on how they plan to achieve this shift towards recycled aggregates, and in doing so, recognise the limitations of relying too heavily on the stick at the expense of the carrot. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Fergus Ewing to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like Willie Rennie, quarrying is a very important industry in my part of Scotland, and companies like Breedon Aggregates are really performing a vital role in our economy, albeit one that is largely out of sight. I did work, as the Minister kindly alluded to, with Alan McKenzie of Breedon Aggregates, formerly of Bear Scotland, who has had lifelong experience in this, and I believe he is, with others in the industry, have engaged with the Minister and have had a very productive and positive experience. So, like Mr Rennie, I would extend my congratulations in the approach that the Minister has taken. And also, I think, although I haven't made a detailed study of it, the committee work, which seems to be very thorough and reasonable. And I welcomed the undertaking, using the words actually, which I had written down to say, the Minister said that stability and continuity will be important considerations. I think that's very important for industry. I spent the best part of 10 years, almost precisely 10 years, Presiding Officer, in charge of ministerial portfolios of energy, business, tourism, and then the rural economy, which is simply different types of businesses. And over all of that period, I found that the key to success, indeed a sine qua non of success, is having the closest possible relationship with business, between business and government. And when I say that, I mean not just a way where we can come together regularly in a formal way, not just ad hoc, but in a regular way, meeting 3 monthly or 6 monthly or something like that, depending upon the nature of the topic, but also that business felt that not only were they being listened to, but their reasonable asks, and many of them don't really involve expenditure, are acted upon. And only then, when that partnership works in that effective way, and that businesses felt that they're not simply being fobbed off, can you make progress. And indeed, I would argue without that relationship, it's simply not possible to understand the complex realities that we frankly do not know, because we're not living the business. That's why I think the main point I wanted to make today in this short speech is that there should be, and I think it should be set out in statute, because then it has to be the case. I'm not really one for prescription by and large, but just in case another government decided to enter into some of the policies that we have seen over the past 3 years, of which members may have noticed I've not been an unqualified fan and devotee, I think it would be a guiding and useful tool that there be in stage two of the bill a provision that there should be some sort of arrangement, Scottish Minerals Forum, would I think. And I think if that commitment were made by the Scottish Government, it would really be seen as very serious by the business, because then it allows issues that we've discussed today about the level of tax, the rate of increase, whether or not you want to give a long-term guarantee. It's always good to give business the assurance that things will not change for a long period, because most capital projects involve 5, 10, 15 years, not short term. Lastly, in the Highlands, the amount of capital projects over the next 10, 20 years is thought to be between £40 and £50 billion. And let's not forget that aggregates is not the master, it's the servant. It exists to enable us to do things. And therefore, we must not forget that when we see that the explanatory memorandum says that the aim is to reduce the extraction of primary aggregates. Well, that can't be at the expense of reducing vital projects, whether they be the A9, whether they be pump storage schemes, or new housing, or hospitals, the Belfer Hospital, all that sort of thing. We can't sacrifice that simply because we want to use less aggregate. That would be absurd. And I just state that because it would be useful if the Scottish Government could make that point clear as well.
Thank you. And I call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Look, frankly, I think there's been far too many apologies this afternoon about this being dry and dull. Certainly, just from the simple point of being able to join my former colleagues from the Finance Committee is a huge pleasure, and can I thank them for their diligent work. But look, while some may simply think that this is a dry debate about gravel, sand and rock and levying tax against it, I think it's actually more important than that in two critical ways. First of all, this is one of the elements of the Smith Commission resulting from the 2016, and I think we do need to think about why it has taken so long. But most importantly, we are talking about aggregates. These are the primary ingredients, the primary products that go into construction. Without wishing to be too glib, we are literally talking about the foundations, the literal foundations of the economy, because economic growth needs to be built. And therefore, looking at actually how this tax will operate is really important for the wider economy. And I'll come on to that for a moment. I would just like to briefly touch on the point, and it's a point that other members have made. The Scotland Act came into 2016, and I, as a committed devolutionist, want devolution to be a dynamic relationship, one in which powers can be explored and taken into this place on a much more dynamic basis. I think we do need to gently ask ourselves why this has taken 8 years. Now, is the aggregates tax going to kind of overnight change the nature of the Scottish Government's finances or the nature of it? No. But I do think we need to look at how we can improve the speed at which we can both adopt new powers but also implement them. But look, more importantly, I think the points that Fergus Ewing has just made are really very important. As I said in the very opening of my contribution, I do believe that economic growth is important. If you're going to have economic growth, you need to build things. One of the things I like to remark upon is that you can do anything in Scotland, from make concrete in Dunbar through to build satellites in Clydebank. And the point about that is twofold. One is about the breadth that we have in the Scottish economy, but critically, the economies only work if you link them up. They only work if you can get goods from point A to point B, whether that's primary inputs or your finished products to your customers. You do need to build and construct roads. I mean, that's why the controversies around the A9 are so important and why we need to look very carefully at this. What we won't want to do is increase the cost of building those vital connections within our economy. Because whether it's roads, whether it's buildings which we need these aggregates, and indeed the future of the Scottish economy, because we need to remember things like floating foundations for offshore may well be constructed from concrete, using aggregates as a primary ingredient of those things. So let us look very carefully. And I think Fergus Ewing makes an excellent suggestion about a mineral products forum, because I think that sort of partnership between government and business is at the very heart of good industrial policy. What business needs is not just to be consulted, not just to have the occasional conversation, but feel that they are in the room when critical decisions are being made, and understanding how those decisions are then going to feed through into government policy, not just within the economy portfolio, but right the way across public policy. But we do need to make sure this tax works. I am mindful of what the Minister said, that the rate will come later, but we do not want to deviate too much. We need stability, but we also need to be mindful that much of Scotland is very close to the border. We don't want to see a situation where our aggregates are being shipped north of the border, because that is cheaper to do so, and essentially that we have a form of arbitrage. But most importantly, we do need to be joined up. I think that I thank Ross Grier for alluding to my comment about the non-fiscal measures. We do need to see an improvement and the recycled content. And we've already seen that. Mineral Products Association point to the fact that we have an increase over the last 10 years in recycled product. But we could go further. When I visited Tarmac recently, they're pointing out road standards could be improved so they could use newer technologies with increased levels of recycled. So that's the sort of non-fiscal measure we need to look at to improve recycled content. And I will stop there. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I call Michelle Thompson, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and it falls to me to shed the last beam of light from the SNP backbenches, so I'll try my best. Firstly, I extend my thanks to the thorough way in which the Minister has carried out his duties. I always have confidence that he's across his brief and well prepared as he appears in front of the FPAC committee. Secondly, to Revenue Scotland, who always exude a certain joy about their role of robust tax collection. I'll comment on some of the themes already covered just briefly. Firstly, the potential tax take for this is very low, assuming that the rate remains the same. Even at the top estimate of £61 million, bear in mind this will be treated as part of the block grant adjustment via the fiscal framework. I suspect the cost of setup will far outweigh any benefit, and I, in common with my colleague John Mason, have to comment on how costs have been allocated. The Scottish Government having to reimburse the UK Government for switching off UCAL and bearing costs of setup is another example of heads Westminster wins and tails Scotland loses. I fear this is a bit of a tinkering tax and it will only have a limited ability to make a difference, be it in driving forward a circular economy, in tax take or in changing consumer behaviour. And I can sense that this is a view shared by opposition parties, but we're all going along with it, so all good so far. My second comment is around data already referenced by others. We don't know how many quarries we have. There appears to be a certain percentage not paying UK tax at all. We have no Scottish disaggregated data from HMRC, and the mechanisms for collecting that data are very uncertain. The report notes, and I quote, "While we understand the current limitations with regards to the availability of disaggregated data for the UK, UCAL in Scotland, the committee is strongly of the view that such data is needed in order to establish the tax elasticity and enable future governments to set an appropriate rate of tax that will achieve the above stated aims whilst effectively managing the challenges and risks of behavioural change." And I think that is an important, albeit slightly technical, comment to make, but I certainly agree. Data, or the lack therein, is something we lack in Scotland. And just recently, I wrote to the Office of National Statistics to inquire about how we can access Scottish-specific data for the likes of CPI inflation, or even those areas that are provided as input to it. And I fear our Scottish Government is having to make financial decisions based on guesswork, and that can't be acceptable. My second theme concerns unregistered quarries, or so-called pop-up quarries with materials taken from a field. And the Stage 1 committee report notes this could be significant. Section 8, bracket 5 of the bill seeks to deal with this position and notes, where there is a supply chain arising from an agreement to supply aggregate, every person in the chain is liable to pay the total amount of tax chargeable on the aggregate as a result of the agreement, unless they've acquired the aggregate from a supplier who's registered for tax. Now, this can only involve significant effort, including visits to sites. Now, whilst Revenue Scotland appeared confident that they can make a difference in this, it does remain to be seen. My final observation is around the opportunity for encouraging the use of secondary aggregates. MPA Scotland stated the UK has seen continued growth in the use of recycled meat materials and secondary aggregates, with a suggestion that 89% of secondary and recycled aggregates are being used within the market. However, in this matter, there's still much that's unknown, and we're clearly some way from utilising this legislation to help improve a circular economy. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches and I call on Maggie Chapman, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to close on behalf of the Scottish Greens this afternoon and I'd like to begin by thanking the Finance and Public Administration Committee for the detailed scrutiny of this legislation and their Stage 1 report. As others have already done, can I also thank those who gave evidence during the Stage 1 process and those who've provided advice and commentary on the legislation. I think I'm the only one in the chamber at the moment this afternoon who was involved in the Smith Commission discussions that led to the 2016 Scotland Act that others have highlighted. Then we were quite clear, further powers for Scotland to design the fiscal levers to suit our own needs were an important outcome of the Smith Commission process. Michael Marra said earlier that he didn't think the devolution of this tax would have been a leading light in those discussions. Well, as much as I love a good gravel tax conversation, I have to admit he's not wrong. But we believe in the importance of taxation for sustaining our economy. Yes, I'll take an intervention from Willie Rennie.
Willie Rennie.
Apologies.
Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, President Officer. We believe in the importance of taxation for sustaining our economy and our communities and for funding our public services. But taxation is not just a revenue-raising measure. It's a tool for behaviour change. On that, we share the Minister's ambitions to create an economy that is green and fair and, importantly, circular. However, we've already heard clearly this afternoon that the aim to maximise the use of secondary materials like processed construction waste is undermined by the already high and increasing rate of recycling in the sector. The rate of recycling is already at about 89%, and so there's clearly room for improvement, but we maybe need to be a little bit more creative and ambitious in how we use this tax. As John Mason has said, the UK rates of taxation have remained unchanged for many years. And while we understand the initial intention to align the tax level with that of the UK aggregates levy, we might be able to achieve more, increased recycling and reuse, of course, but also more than that. There's a lack of solid research and data describing what exactly the potential is, considering the underdeveloped market for construction and demolition wastes. Increasing rates of tax may provide the incentive and funding for such research to be done. Local authorities are clearly a key stakeholder in all of this because they will be affected in two major ways. First, they'll be liable for tax themselves, being the proprietors of first point commercial exploitation of taxable aggregates. Second, there is a safety element to the use of recycled materials, which local authorities are bound to observe and enforce. Reliefs and possibly exemptions might be needed to offset this disproportionate burden and the ultimate purpose of public infrastructure and service delivery. But that's maybe a discussion for another day. With this bill, we need to consider the resources Revenue Scotland will require to ensure that all liable taxpayers are identified and monitored over time. And I've already touched on the importance of data, the importance of really understanding what we have. So I look forward to the publication by both the Scottish and UK governments of some of this data next year. Finally, Presiding Officer, a brief comment on part two of the bill. We welcome the Minister's assurances that there will be engagement and consultation with the public and relevant stakeholders before the introduction of any regulations relevant to the measures contained in Part 2. We also look forward to the parliamentary scrutiny of those regulations, particularly regarding the provisions on automation. And we welcome the commitment by the Minister to make sure that all of those regulations fit in line with our broader tax objectives. So in closing, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Greens welcome the establishment of the Scottish Aggregates Tax, and we will be pleased to support this bill at decision time. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Michael Mara. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Labour does welcome the introduction of the Scottish Aggregates Tax, and I thank members for their contributions in the debate this afternoon. And in the week that we have marked the 25th anniversary of this Parliament, it does seem somewhat fitting that we are getting on with the work of further devolution today. Decisions that are being taken closer to home. But crucially, these decisions are being taken in a way which recognises the context in which we are working and seeks to build a constructive relationship with UK counterparts and how we interact in that regard. And Fergus Ewing and Daniel Johnson both touched on how crucial those relationships are, but also the relationship with business for this Parliament and this Scottish Government. I would echo those thoughts. Nothing could be more important when we consider the tax regimes than we have, than how it turns towards productivity rather than the opposite in suppressing economic activity in Scotland. I do think it would be, given the comments from across the chamber, fitting if the Minister could provide further clarity and reiteration as to how the Scottish Government intends to balance this, the issue of continuity and stability for business alongside their plans for the circular economy, and realise that those are the full extent of that commitment will be set out in the budget process in terms of when the tax rates are set But I think it would be good to have those assurances again on the record today from the Minister in his closing remarks. There's been quite a lot of discussion about data today, the lack of it principally. Michelle Thompson and Jamie Hall-Crowe-Johnson both talked about the disaggregation of data, crucially across the UK, data that's held in Whitehall, that would be better able to use if it was disaggregated appropriately for Scotland. I would say as much for policy development as well as the issues of scrutiny that have been highlighted in relation to the Parliament. But also the other area of data that was discussed was, I suppose, the issue of what we've been heard about, some of the secret quarries around Scotland. And it's fair to say that the Finance Committee have been slightly sceptical about as to how you might hide a quarry. But the evidence that we have had from the industry is that these forms of activities do go on, and that they are concerned about the lack of compliance with the current taxation regime. Revenue Scotland have said that they are aware of the issue, but the level of non-compliance is not yet fully understood due to that lack of data. Anecdotal evidence would suggest there could be a significant amount of potential revenue that has been lost to the public purse on that regard. And the provisions in the bill obviously do seek to improve compliance, and they are certainly welcome, but more data would help with this. I would also draw the Government's attention to the Finance Committee's recommendation that Revenue Scotland work very closely with local authorities to identify potential areas of unregistered activity in local areas. And I know that Revenue Scotland would always be happy to hear from people who have complaints and suspicions in this regard. In my opening speech, I touched on some of the concerns regarding Part 2 of the bill, and some of my Finance Committee colleagues have raised the possibility of a finance bill. I know that that's something that the Minister has answered questions on to the committee before. I do think it's something the Scottish Government should at least commit to looking at and to having to consider. The Parliament has far more fiscal powers than it did back in 1999. Perhaps there should be a mechanism that could be developed for updating those regulations on an annual basis so we can ensure that the taxations are put to their best productive ends. And of course, there were some concerns expressed about Part 2 of the bill that could have been addressed at the early stage had the Government consulted on this part of the legislation. A range of stakeholders, including the Chartered Institute of Taxation, the Institute of Chartered Accountants Scotland and the Law Society expressed their disappointment at the failure to consult in this area. As the committee's Stage 1 report states, by not consulting on these provisions before the bill was laid, a valuable opportunity for the Scottish Government to discuss stakeholders' concerns was lost. And I'm yet to hear a convincing argument as to why that consultation was not undertaken as part of the legislation. I would close, Presiding Officer, by reiterating the comments of many of the contributors today about Daniel Johnson put it well, said we are literally talking about the foundations of the economy here. This is vitally important. A colleague highlighted the housing emergency, which we agreed in this chamber yesterday. If we're going to see the vast increase in house building that we require in this country, we're not just going to need a better planning system, a better government regulation of it, a more proactive approach to the funding of it. We are going to need sand, and we have to make sure that we get this right.
Thank you. I call on Jamie Hall-Crowe-Johnson, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I suggested in my opening contribution, we are supportive of the general principles of the bill, but not without some of the same concerns as held by the Finance Committee. As expressed by other colleagues, we do believe it's right to create incentives for investment in recycling, encouraging the use of recycled material where possible and divert natural material away from landfill. This is in line with the environmental objectives of this Parliament. And, of course, while it might have taken us 8 years to get to this point, devolution of certain taxes is in line with the 2016 changes to the Scotland Act. But I think one of the main challenges we face, and which has been highlighted in a number of speeches across the Chamber today, is the uncertainty over potential behavioural change and how that impacts on elasticities of demand for the different aggregates. And this is an important issue because it answers to these challenges that really should be key in determining how we vote at Stage 3. Because if it became clear that the new tax might have to increase above the existing rate of the UK aggregates levy in order to create a stronger push towards recycling, and remembering that, as we made clear earlier, that is something that witnesses suggested against, and the Minister also hinted were important considerations on how changes were made going forward, then we would also have to weigh up whether any higher tax level could actually deter people from recycling. In other words, just as is the case for other devolved taxes, we have to weigh up what will actually happen in practice. And again, I reiterate the point that I made earlier and has been made by many contributions, and that's the problem compounded by the fact that we're really struggling to harness sufficient data one way or another. We do not know what UCAL data is relevant to Scotland, nor do we have sufficient data to model the likely changes. And that is a real challenge, and one that highlights an issue that I know my colleague Liz Smith and the Finance Committee more generally have been extremely vocal on for a long time. That is, there a need for increasing transparency over taxation. The committee has made it very clear that much more research needs to be undertaken before any informed decisions can be made, both to get a better handle of the different tax, different elasticities, but also to try and set the rates of the proposed new tax. Again, that matter is important in determining the final stage voting of the outcome of the bill. If I can turn briefly to some of the other contributions that we've had today. Tom Arthur talked about the engagement with stakeholders. I think that's extraordinarily important, obviously, going forward. There hasn't, I think one of the committee concerns that wasn't in depth enough in terms of part two of the bill. But I do welcome that the Scottish Government, as highlighted by Fergus Ewing, will consider the calls for a Scottish Minerals Forum. Of course, it has to meet, and it has to be an important partner on that going before. And also, as raised by Daniel Johnson and commented on by the Minister, that this tax will be only part of a suite of options that will go forward. Liz Smith highlighted that the issues, again, that I raised around the quality of the product and how that may impact in terms of how recycling recycled materials are used, and of course low costs for landfill still may hold down actual use going forward, and also again the lack of data, which was a real issue going forward. And I agree, I think again I'll say it with Michelle Thompson's points, that you know this is an issue around HMRC, and this is an opportunity as well for these things to be improved going forward. Michael Mara talked about the limits of the use of recycled material, and also warned of moving away from any potential alignment with the UK, and I think that's absolutely right. Rather like Ross Greer, I wasn't able to attend the quarry visit. I also didn't get any stone or rock or anything like that. I'm not sure that would have been seen as commercial exploitation had we received anything as well as gifts, but it was certainly very disappointing. Willie Rennie's contribution, I mean, I was shocked by it, as I think the Chamber were. He described this as a dull subject, which really shows, I think, a politician that can't find the passion in anything. I was very disappointed. He also rather shamelessly moved his affections, seemingly, or his praising from Jamie Hepburn onto Tom Arthur, the minister, without a blink of an eye. Poor Jamie Hepburn must be struggling somewhere on this one. And of course, then he just involved himself in a disruptive approach to poor Maggie Chapman's speech when calling for interventions. It was a pretty shameful episode from Willie Rennie. Brian Whittle rightly highlighted some of the impacts around farmers extracting off their land, and just remind the members of my register of interest as a partner in a farming business. And also highlighted the potential use of technology. There isn't a lot of detail, but of course there may well be options around AI and drones, etc. But they have to be done in a manner which doesn't lead to kind of public trust being lost. And just to reiterate Fergus Ewing's point, it's a point I made around housing, and he made around housing, but also, of course, around construction on projects like the A9, which is so vital, and we do not want to see these situations made any more difficult by these taxes. So, if I can just move on, Presiding Officer, the data issue is not going to be going away anytime soon, and the committee has encountered situations where data is either incomplete or non-existent. And we also continue to have concerns over non-compliance, about the tensions between keeping the tax simple for business while meeting the objectives of maximising recycling, the lack of consultation, as I mentioned, with stakeholders in part two of the bill, and also some of the issues around how disputes will be resolved. And, of course, whether revenue raised by the new tax and the block grant adjustment agreed between the two governments will be aligned. However, we will support the bill at this stage, and we look forward to reassurances and possible amendments as it progresses.
Thank you, and I call on Tom Arthur to wind up. Up to 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by thanking members from across the Chamber today for their constructive contributions, and also thank those members who have engaged constructively with me and the sector as this legislation has been under development, and to thank the committee and all who gave evidence to the committee again and for the committee's report, which I think makes a very positive and, as I say again, constructive contribution. There is two, I think, main themes that have emerged specific to the aggregates tax component of this legislation, which is the issue of data and the issue of this balance between a circular economy and also continuity. Now, I would be very tempted to say that giving it this tax will go live if the bill is passed by Parliament and it proceeds as anticipated, would go live in the spring of 2026. So I would be expecting, and it would be the central issue of contention in the Scottish parliamentary elections, and let the people decide what the respective levy should be. But I think the points that have been made get to the heart of why it's so important that we take a very balanced and measured approach, which is this issue of data. Now, the reasons for why we have a lack of data have been well rehearsed, and they are not entirely within our gift to resolve. But with the tax coming online and with that operational experience that Revenue Scotland will gain, that will begin to provide that data to allow more informed decisions to be taken going forward. Now, as I've said previously, while I cannot preempt what decisions will be taken for the 26-27 budget, what I would say is I think we will have an opportunity in considering the rate at that point to weigh up not just the arguments that we've had today specifically about the theoretical balance between continuity and circular economy objectives, but taking into account what are the prevailing economic circumstances at that time, and indeed, importantly, what decisions the UK government takes at that particular point as well. They will be vital considerations. But I think the key to this has to be something that recognises the significant importance, as members across the chamber this afternoon have recognised, of the importance of the aggregates industry. And while we want to clearly continue with the work that the existing UK aggregates levy has been seeking to promote, that incentivisation of using secondary and recycled aggregates, we do have to recognise a point Fergus Ewan has made very powerfully, is that primary aggregates are still of significant importance to our economy, and they will continue to be so. And so the point that Fergus Ewan made about looking at a deliberative forum in which we can ensure that there is continued engagement with industry that builds upon the constructive engagement that we've had to date, I think is an excellent one. And I think in terms of the desired outcomes and effects of such a forum are things that we need to secure. The point I would make, and I think it is worthy of discussion ahead of stage two of the legislation, is just to clarify, are there any existing bodies or forums that we could use, or does this require something bespoke? But that is a point of process, simply to ensure efficiency and avoid any duplication. But I think in terms of the objective of a forum, of ensuring that ongoing engagement to ensure that regulation is proportionate and actually can be a driver for innovation, investment and entrepreneurship, and not something that suffocates or closes off those things, that has got to be important. And that's why it's absolutely vital we have that continued engagement with business. Because fundamentally, when we have people who have been working in the sector for decades, they will grasp things like that, which would take others who are new to the sector months of work. We must, in terms of developing regulation, of developing legislation, ensure we are harnessing and bringing to bear the collective expertise of all our people in business and across every sector. That has played a big part in getting the legislation to the place it is today, and I think it will be absolutely vital as we take the legislation forward to stage two and stage three in Parliament, and indeed in implementation. Now, there's a number of points I want to pick up on that have been addressed. There was a question that Michael Mara raised around the proportionality of offset measures. I'd want to reassure Mr Mara that there will be detailed guidance provided by Revenue Scotland. However, I do understand the existing concerns, and ministers will be giving serious consideration ahead of the latter stages of the legislation as whether that's something that should be made explicit on the legislation. And similarly, with the provisions around communication and automation, I would reiterate those commitments I made at stage two to the committee of the vital importance of strong parliamentary engagement and public consultation. I think we all recognise there's tremendous opportunities for the application of AI and reforming our public services to make them more efficient, but we have to do so in a way that commands confidence. I think key to commanding confidence will be that full public engagement and parliamentary scrutiny. There has also been the issue raised of a finance bill, inter alia other discussions that we've had this afternoon. I would reiterate the points that I have made previously at committee, that ministers are very open to this discussion. I would just note, as I have previously, this is also a matter for Parliament, and that is not to seek ministers. Clearly, the government has a key role to play. But given the spirit of the Budget Review Group in the previous session, given that this is ultimately about how Parliament, which is ultimately responsible for supply, determines budget processes, we have to have that level of engagement. But I think this would be a fruitful project and something that could potentially inform how we take forward our processes in the next session of Parliament, and does speak to that point that we have taken on significantly more fiscal powers than we have had previously. And having that certainty and continuity around a clear rhythm of opportunities for care and maintenance, I think something to be welcomed by stakeholders and would afford Parliament the opportunity for greater scrutiny. But these things, of course, will require detailed consideration. Willie Rennie, and I thank him very much for his kind remarks. He had highlighted some amendments that have been suggested by the Law Society. What I would say is we'll, of course, give very serious consideration to any amendments that are brought forward. We do have to bear in mind the scope of the legislation before us here, where the second part is about broad administrative matters. We also have to consider if there's opportunities through secondary legislation to remedy any of these issues. But I will take very seriously the points that he's raised on that matter. And I would reiterate the points that I made earlier, which he highlighted again, around that need for ensuring that we take a balanced and measured approach to ensure the decisions we take on this tax are fully evidenced. Key points that have been touched on both by Daniel Johnson and indeed Ross Greer on his contribution was regards to not seeing this fiscal lever in isolation, and that is of utmost importance. And indeed, I think that has been evidenced by the approach that we have taken to date, recognising that we have to go and build up our knowledge and understanding of the data underpinning the fiscal implications around tax with regards to the aggregates industry. But recognising that that will also be dependent on wider economic factors, decisions that the UK government takes about UK aggregates levy operating in the rest of the UK, and also the broader regulatory environment. So these things are of utmost importance. Presiding officer, I'd also just want to extend my thanks to all other members who contributed. Just as a point of clarity, there was a question around why it would take 8 years to delay. There were existing UK and European challenges around the UK aggregates levy, which were not resolved until, I think, it was around about 2019. So it was really only a matter that we could take forward in this Parliament. And the legislation has been taken forward in a way that has sought to ensure the greatest opportunity for the engagement of industry. So again, I thank members for their contributions and engagement this afternoon. And the Government looks forward to continued engagement as we take this legislation forward. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Aggregates Tax and Devolved Taxes Administration Scotland Bill at Stage 1. It's time to move to the next item of business, which is consideration of Motion 12713 in the name of Shona Robison on a financial resolution for the Aggregates Tax and Devolved Taxes Administration Scotland Bill. And I call on Tom Arthur to move the motion.
Moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. I have a point of order from Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I seek your guidance on the importance of accurate contributions from members of this chamber. At First Minister's questions earlier today, Anna Sarwar said that Inverclyde's out of hours GP service has been permanently closed. This is factually inaccurate, and this misinformation could cause severe alarm to my constituents. And to be absolutely clear, Inverclyde residents still will have access to a full GP out-of-hours service. The level of local direct provision is in contrast to regional provision is a different debate. But saying also, it is of the utmost importance that accuracy is at the forefront of everything that we do in this chamber. And I seek your guidance on how a member could correct the record after sharing such misinformation.
Thank you, Mr. McMillan. Points of order relate to whether proper parliamentary procedures have been or are being followed, and the point that Mr. McMillan raises relates to accuracy, which is not a matter for the Chair to rule on. Members will be aware, of course, of the scrutiny measures available to them to pursue matters, and members will also be aware of the mechanism that exists for correcting the record. We will now move on to the next item of business, and that is consideration of motion 13172 in the name of Karen Adam on behalf of the selection panel on appointment of the chair of the Scottish Commission for Human Rights. And I call on Karen Adam to speak to and move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the cross-party selection panel established by the Presiding Officer under our standing orders, I am delighted to be speaking to the motion in my name to invite members of the Parliament to agree to nominate Professor Angela O'Hagan to His Majesty the King for appointment as the Chair of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. The Presiding Officer chaired the selection panel, and the other members were Miles Briggs, Maggie Chapman, Katie Clark and Nicola Sturgeon. As members will be aware, the Scottish Human Rights Commission is the national human rights institution for Scotland, and its role is to promote human rights and, in particular, to encourage best practice in relation to human rights. Turning to our nominee, who is in the gallery, I believe, with us today, Professor Angela O'Hagan is currently Professor of Equality and Public Policy at Glasgow Caledonian University. And she is also the Deputy Director of the WISE Centre for Economic Justice. Angela's career encompasses leadership roles in the community and statutory sectors in Scotland, including as Director of Carers Scotland and as Head of Campaigns and Communications with Oxfam Scotland. She has served on a number of advisory and project groups with successive Scottish governments, including currently as the independent chair of the Equality and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group and the National Advisory Council on Women and Girls. Angela has an international profile, particularly in gender and human rights budgeting, and through membership of academic and civil society networks. The panel believes that Angela's blend of skills, knowledge and experience will make her an excellent chair. Together with the members, she will ensure that the Scottish Human Rights Commission fulfils its statutory duties and that the office is run efficiently and effectively and meets its strategic objectives. Presiding Officer, I move this motion.
Thank you, Ms Adam. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. And the next item of business is consideration of motion 13096 in the name of Maggie Chapman on behalf of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body on appointment of a member of the Scottish Commission for Public Audit. And I call on Maggie Chapman to speak to and move the motion.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Corporate Body is pleased to nominate Jamie Green to be a member of the Scottish Commission for Public Audit. Given it's Thursday evening, though, and we are all very well acquainted with Jamie's many qualities and skills, I'll do so formally.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. There are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion 13221 in the name of Tom Arthur on Aggregates Tax and Devolved Taxes Administration Scotland Bill at Stage 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 12713 in the name of Shona Robison on a financial resolution for the Aggregates Tax and Devolved Taxes Administration Scotland Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 13172 in the name of Karen Adam on behalf of the selection panel on appointment of the chair of the Scottish Commission for Human Rights be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And the final question is that motion 13096 in the name of Maggie Chapman on behalf of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body on appointment of a member of the Scottish Commission for Public Audit be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.